what's the difference between active and recessive? Listen up, my friend. The whole idea revolves around this. They tell you that inside the CAN controller circuit, there are two error counters, one for transmitting errors and another for receiving errors. Now let's focus on this. If an error occurs during transmission, the transmission counter increases by 8. We'll dive deeper into that later. And if you receive an error, you increase the reception error counter by 1. If any of these counters exceed 96, it indicates the controller is in the year active state. If the count continues and surpasses 127 times, then your controller enters the passive error state. If it goes beyond 255 times, you've entered the bus off state. Remember, each state has its status. So now your CAN controller can be in one of three states. If you make a transmission and it doesn't complete or there's an error, you increment the transmission error counter by 8 times. If you receive an error, you increase your receive error counter by just once. If afterward, what you've sent gets an acknowledgement and everything is running smoothly, you decrease the transmission counter by 1. And if you receive something correctly, you decrease the reception counter by 1. So if you don't decrease the count and it keeps rising until it reaches 96, you're in the active error state. If it exceeds 127 times, you're in the passive error state. And if it goes beyond 256 times, you're in the bus off state. So if you're in the passive error state, you'll send the first 6 bits as zeros. Following that, there's the error echo. This means that what you write in the error flag, you rewrite in the error echo. Lastly, the delimiter has 2 parts with 8 ones. This is the error frame, everyone. To repeat, if an error occurs in your transmission, you send an error frame and increase your counter. The error frame you send indicates which state you're in, whether it's active or passive. If you're in the passive state, you send the error frame shown below in the image. If you're in the active state, you send the one above. Let's delve into an example together in case study 4. You have node A with both transmit and receive functions. It sent data to the transceiver and the transceiver attempted to send it over the bus. But there wasn't anyone connected to the bus at that moment. So the send data didn't receive an acknowledgement. Realizing that no one had received the data, it then sent an error frame. Now let's discuss another type of frames called the overload frame. When does the overload frame appear? It shows up when the receiving node is overloaded. It keeps on receiving data, but the software hasn't read from its mailbox yet. So as a receiver, you continue to accept data from the IDE within your range and it's accepted. You keep on receiving and storing it in the mailbox. Your mailbox gets filled up, first one, then 2, then 3. With 3 being the last, what should we do then, folks? Well, in the software, you don't want to access the interrupt service routine or you don't want to engage in the polling mechanism to read the received items. So my mailbox is full, but I'm still receiving. At this point, the node sends an overload frame to signal that it's overloaded, meaning it's not able to detect and receive incoming messages. The overload frame also starts with a transition from 1 to 0, followed by an overload flag, then an echo, and finally, the delimiters. Its structure is mostly zeros, 6 zeros to be exact, followed by echo bits, which are also zeros, and then the delimiters are ones. Now, you might ask, isn't this structure the same as the active error frame? After all, the latter also has 6 echo zeros followed by 8 delimiters with a value of 1. So how does my CAN controller RX differentiate between these two when it receives such a structure? By the way, this is an interview question, but is typically posed to senior roles, not juniors. The overload frame is identical to an active error. The only difference is that the overload frame doesn't increase the error counter and doesn't cause a transmission of a frame. What does this mean? It means that for both the active error and the passive error, when I send a frame representing either of them, don't I send it after I increment the error counter based on whether it's in transmission or reception? So it tells you that the overload frame and the active error frame are the same. But the main difference is that I increment a counter in the error frame, while in the overload, I don't increment anything. So how does the CAN controller's MUC layer, which receives 6 zeros followed by 6 echo bits, which are also zeros, and then 8 ones as delimiters, differentiate whether it's an error frame or an overload frame? Here's the trick. It says, the CAN bus has a very powerful trick up its sleeve. The overload frame and the error frame look identical. However, the CAN node can differentiate them based on timing. Remember this with me. When I used to send a frame, what was it composed of at the very least? It started with the start of frame, and at the very end, there was an end of frame. And after the end of frame, wasn't there an interframe space known as the ifs? Was the is composed of three ones or not? And after that, the subsequent frame begins. Now, in the case of receiving, the overload frame will only occur during the interframe space. So in the case of the overload frame, while transmitting, the interframe space and an overload occurs. Listen closely, because this part is crucial. ECU1 sends the frame with the ID understood by ECU2. ECU2 keeps receiving, and as soon as it receives the end of frame, it finds out that it has no space left. Its mailbox is full. At this very moment, ECU1 sends the ifs to separate between the frames. This means no one should use the bus for just 3 bits. ECU2, upon detecting the end of frame, couldn't accommodate the ifs, so it immediately responds with an overload frame. This overload frame is sent during the ifs or interframe space. So all of a sudden, during the ifs with the UI1s, it notices the bus drops for 6 bits of a 0, followed by 6 echo bits of 0, and then 8 bits of 1. Instantly, it recognizes that it's an overload frame, but in the case of the error frame, it is sent normally after the interframe space has occurred. This is where time plays a part. If it's an overload, it interrupts the ifs, which are the 3 bits of ones that separate the frames. If it's an error frame, then no, it's treated like a regular frame. It waits for the bus to complete the 3 ifs bits, and then it's transmitted. Do you all understand now how we differentiate between the overload frame and the error frame? In this view, as soon as I send the 7 bits for the end of frame, I immediately send the overload frame and cut the part where he was about to place the 3 and the single ones of the ifs. Pay attention, look at. Normally, the echo should range from 1 to 6, but here he has made it just 1. Focus on this point with me. It's crucial. So here's an example. I send data frame 1, then data frame 2, and then I send remotely frame 3 saying, hey everyone, someone sent to the ID, which is D3 for instance. Take note and follow along with me. Then you send D4 and face the transmission error. You sent and there was an issue. You found out that the frame failed due to a specific event that disrupted everything. As a result, you immediately sent an error frame after D4. Keep that in mind. So you send the 4 again. It's possible that during receiving, the error frame was received incorrectly and an error frame was sent in response. So when you notice they sent an error frame as a transmitter, you send D4 again. Be attentive to this detail. Then you send D5. It seemed like the receiver was unable to receive at that moment. So it sent you an overload frame and this interrupted the ifs. Let's focus on this point. Let's dive into the CAN bus characteristics. What are they? Take a moment and listen closely. We have a processor that will communicate with the CAN controller. It sends via text digital and receives via X digital. And of course, every time it sends, it receives from the bus to monitor the bits, understanding what's happening on the bus naturally. The transceiver is what translates this to CAN high and CAN low. Let's focus on this. Let's take a look at this image. What does this image convey? I have a Cortex M processor, which embedded inside it interrupt controller, which is name, the CP connected to the DMA and the RAM. We also have the CAN controller from which a DMA signal emerges because it might operate with it, instructing it to send and receive. Keep up with me here. This means it requests the DMA to send to it. The DMA has a master port. The information we discussed in Unit 6 quickly goes to the RAM to fetch the data and send it. At the same time, the CAN controller has a slave to configure the registers in it, and it has an interrupt directed to the JIC to forward it to the processor. Let's focus on this detail. From the CAN controller, we have DX and NRX outputs. These are digital signals and they are single-ended, not differential. They are single-wise as TX and RX, directed to the CAN transceiver, which translates this information into CAN high and CAN low. Take a moment to understand this. The CAN high and CAN low are connected to the bus, which has termination resistances, each being 120 ohms. Of course, there's node B, which is connected to the bus via high and low. Be attentive to this point. Of course, the CAN transceiver's differential signals, which are CAN high and CAN low, aren't where we place the logic analyzer. We place the logical analyzer on TX and RX because it reads digital, not the bus's analog ranges. Let's keep this in mind.